So we have our Honorable Minister, Mr. Shashi Tharoor, here with us for the MBA Grand Challenge 2009. So welcome to the show.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much for taking the time on your busy schedule to be with us. It will be a big inspiration for our students, you as a thought leader and as an author, to us more important than being the minister. But she'll be very glad that you could make it today. I would like you to start off with by giving our viewers, especially those maybe who have not read this book, a quick overview of the elephant, the tiger, and the cell phone.
Well, it's a collection of short pieces, essays, some very short, they appeared in newspapers before, some slightly longer, of which the unifying theme broadly is the recent transformation of India in the last decade and more. In particular, the title refers to an essay which describes India through the metaphor of an elephant, a slow, ponderous, lumbering beast covered in dust and flies, slow to move, slow to change, which in recent years appears to have been acquiring the stripes of an agile, life-insinuate tiger. And the question one asks is that transformation complete? No, it's not complete. It is incomplete, but it's progressing well. What are the factors behind that transformation? What are the dangers to that transformation? What are the opportunities there? And I chose the cell phone as the third element of the title because I think that the cell phone has become an instrument for the empowerment of poor Indians. In many ways, what is striking about India's change is best captured by the story of the cell phone, because like you, I grew up in an India where telephones were very rare, where not only did very few people have them, that a member of parliament actually had the right to allocate 15 telephone connections to whomever they deemed worthy. Such a rare privilege was it to have a phone. And what is more, the phones weren't very effective. They functioned very badly. You often couldn't get a dial tone. You dialed a number, you got the wrong number very often. There were cross connections, which is when you got somebody else's conversation that you suddenly stumbled across. Those are connections that made us very cross. So all of this was the era. And in fact, at one point, a member of parliament in 1984 stood up and asked the communications minister, what accounted for this terrible, terrible performance of phones. And his answer was that communications are a luxury in a developing country, not a right, that the government had no obligation to provide a good telephone service, and that if the honorable member was not happy with his telephone, could he please return it, because there was an 8-year long waiting list for people waiting for the phones. Now, that sort of attitude also had to change. And what we have seen since the days of Rajiv Gandhi is an opening up of the communication space, so that today, with cell phones in people's hands, you not only have that end of that old attitude, now telephones are seen as a necessity, not a luxury, but the government has made it possible for us to have some of the cheapest cell phone rates in the world, and ordinary people have benefited in the biggest way. In the old days, a farmer, once he had done his harvest, would have to either go himself or send a young, able-bodied relative, maybe an 8-year-old boy, walking 4, 6, 10 kilometers to the nearest market town, to find out whether the market was open, whether the product he had harvested could be sold there, what the competition was, what the price it would fetch. Then the child would have to walk back another 8 or 10 kilometers. They would then load the carts and go. Half a day's backbreaking work, which is now solved by 1 2-minute phone call. The same thing with fishermen. In Kerala now, we have more and more fishermen who can afford to take cell phones out to sea. And as they come back with their catch, they call the market towns along the coast to see where you can get the best price for your fish. So in other words, the cell phone has become an instrument for the empowerment of the underclass of India. And that to me is its biggest strength. In the book, I've written that we set a new record when we sold 7 million cell phones in April 2007, because that was when I was putting the book to bed, went off to press at that time. But by the time the book came out, that figure was already out of date. By the end of 2007, we had broken our own world record twice. We had broken it several times since then. Earlier this year, I saw the astonishing figure that we have sold 15 million cell phones in 1 month. Now, that is boggling the mind. Do you know, when I left India to go to graduate school in America, the entire country had only 2 million landline telephones? In 1 month, we're selling 15 million. It's just astonishing. We are now the second largest telephone market in the world. We're larger than the United States. Only China is ahead of us, but we're growing much faster than China, much faster. So the result is that India is being transformed by the cell phone. The elephant is becoming a tiger because of the cell phone. That's the story.
Sir, but how come then we're not making any cell phones?
That's a very good question. We have not done as well in the hard industries of development. When it comes to something like software, we are superb. when it comes to actually manufacturing the components that go into a phone, we are far behind the Chinese. So the cell phones manufactured by Finnish and Swedish and Japanese companies often have many parts manufactured in China. We need to get to that stage in India. I don't think we may end up manufacturing the entire phone. In China, they do that too.
Yeah, they do that too.
But in India, if we can get to manufacture some components that can go into an assembly, that'll also be an accomplishment. We're doing this in cars.
Yeah.
Today, India has become a very important manufacturer of essential parts for vehicles, for cars. We don't really have an equivalent in the cell phone area.
But if the government's policy had been a little different, wouldn't it have forced even the foreign manufacturers to maybe manufacture at least part of the domestic consumption here in India?
One could argue that case, because part of the problem is that investors are reluctant to come to our country for anything that involves employing large numbers of people because of our labor laws. The fact is our labor laws are written to protect the jobs of those who already have them, rather than to encourage the creation of more jobs for people who don't have them. And that's partly wrong with our own mentality, is that instead of having an attitude to the economy that says the more we open up the economy, the more jobs there will be for everyone, we think in terms of scarcity and we say we have to protect what we have. And this is an attitude and problem that is not easy to change. As you know, China has done much of its growth by suspending all their rules and requirements and having special economic zones. We don't want to go that route either, because there we feel that a number of workers are exploited.
Yeah.
But the problem in our case is a number of workers may be not exploited, but a large number of people are not getting jobs.
But China may be not only in their domestic laws, but in applying their strength or their abilities to the rest of the world, they seem to have been more clever than us. Would you agree? Or?
Well, China has done well. They've gone ahead of us. I don't feel we should be comparing, Sam. The fact is that as far as India is concerned, we have a different history. We have a different political system. We are a democracy. We don't do things the way the Chinese do them. And we certainly don't impose upon people the way in which the Chinese system permits the authorities to do. But we're not here to compare ourselves to China. They are already way ahead of us. In the 1970s, we had the same GDP per capita. Today, the Chinese are four or five times ahead of us. And I think that to even get into a competition mindset is unfortunate. What we should do is get into a complementarity mindset. We have some strengths they don't have. They have some strengths we don't have. Let's work together. And that means, for example, that we are opening branches of our IT firms in China.
Yep.
We are actually hiring Chinese for Infosys in Bangalore. We are giving visas to the Chinese to come here and invest their money. So all of these things are happening. And as far as I'm concerned, we should look at that as an opportunity and not be distracted too much by the competition. We are our own country. We have our own limitations and our own strengths.
In the preface of this book, you quote, India must rise above the past if we are to conquer the future. Could you elaborate a little bit on?
Well, I think too much of our politics in particular has been bedeviled by battles over history. If you look at something like the Ram Janmabhoomi agitation, if you look at what happened in Gujarat in 2002, these are old hatreds that are unnecessarily being raked up and being played out in the 21st century. What we need to do, to be quite honest, is to say what happened in the past belongs in the past. Let us construct a better India for all of our children in the future. And that means being prepared to put aside certain lessons of the past. You know, I'm certainly not somebody who says forget history. I'm an amateur historian myself. I did my first degree in history. I love reading history. I love writing aspects of history. But don't let's become prisoners of history. History is extremely interesting. There are lessons we can learn from it. But frequently we are learning the wrong lessons. And learning the lessons that we must today undo the damage that may have been done 500 years ago by a particular ruler is the kind of unconstructive attitude that doesn't take our country forward. We should be thinking much more about tomorrow than about yesterday.
You covered Kerala very well in this book. You know, we were all thrilled at the number of Kerala articles. Hope you were not planning for the election then. Just a joke. But mostly all the positives. I mean, you know, as Malayalis, we know we are all also saddled with a lot of negatives. You know, the social obligations which kill the work ethic in Kerala, the consumption economy, the gold craze, you know, the alcoholism which we can't avoid, So these are, these seem to be very serious issues. And as a businessman, I also found that when you try to start something here, lack of experienced personnel also, because all the guys are out, you know. Anybody reasonably good have moved out of the country. So we feel there's a big scarcity of experienced people in Kerala. So how are we going to, or what are your comments on those, or views on
that? Yeah, first of all, I agree that the book is not very negative, partly because I was trying to counteract the widespread negative image of Kerala amongst those who knew about India. So people reading a book on India start off with a prejudice against Kerala, except when it comes to our social development, literacy, medicine, newspapers, all of that. But when it comes to economics, then perception is negative. So I wanted to counteract that, and to that degree, I emphasize the positive. Having said that, it's true that there are a lot of negatives, and one of the negatives we have is definitely our attitude to work. Whether we are more conscious of our rights than of our responsibilities, whether ideology tends to prevail over results, and therefore we tend, frankly, to be far readier to go on samarams and hartals and bans than to actually produce effective results in terms of working outputs. And that we don't seem to behave here the way in which the same young people are prepared to behave in the Gulf or Saudi Arabia. They go there, they work very hard, they have a tremendous reputation. Malayalis in the Middle East have a fantastic reputation for being loyal, hardworking, honest, efficient, productive. The moment they come back to Kerala, they either want to put their feet up and relax, or it seems they don't want to work.
The social obligations too, you know, somebody is dead, or you know, even far relatives, I mean, you're very obliged to go if you're in Kerala. If you're working outside, you know, you're not expected to go. So
we do have a lot of expatriation, and you're quite right that often various kinds of obligations seem to take precedence over the work culture. So that is a problem, and we need to help overcome it partly through an attitudinal change. We have to demonstrate that we are being left behind. As long as we have the escape valve of people going abroad to work in the Middle East, and they are sending remittances back home, people won't see that. But if the day comes when those opportunities start drying up, and we know that we have not created a proper work environment in Kerala, then we will realize how much the state needs a change of attitude.
So the MBA students and all of us look up to you. You're a big inspiration to us. But the students here, especially in Kerala, face a lot of disadvantages when you compare with the students in the cities. The MBA students, I mean, you know, the comparative facilities and the guidance that they receive. So what would be your advice to them in their competition, in building up their careers in the future?
Now, my first advice is they are in no way inferior to anybody from a big metropolitan city. I don't believe that brains are distributed by size of
the
population.
I mean, you know,
that's it. That's exactly the point I was going to make. That ultimately, you can only study in the environment that you have. But thereafter, what you do with your book knowledge is what determines your effectiveness. In other words, the exposure that comes from working in other environments. So my advice to them is do your MBA in whichever place you are in Kerala. Do it well, study hard, be confident of the concepts and the lessons you've learned. But thereafter, take risks. Take positions in Kerala and outside Kerala. In Kerala, take positions with outside companies, working with non-Malayalis. Try and interact sufficiently with others that you start getting exposed, as you said, to other ways of thinking, functioning, other kinds of cultural habits, other kinds of assumptions. And thereby, you will be in a position to make a real difference when it comes to your being able to set forth yourself. I have met so many Malayalis, and my own father was one of them, who went straight from a village to a big city, learned the hard way, and then showed they could excel against people who had been in the big city all their lives. That, I can assure you, is going to be the case of many of your MBA students. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.